My name is Apple D. Yeah, my name is Tabu No Washington.
My name is Will.i.am,
and we the Black Eyed Peas.
And we chilling with my man Tony J. The spot where the spot gives.
For the past 15 years, William Adams, a.k.a. Will.i.am, has been the backbone and driving creative force behind the Black Eyed Peas. He personifies everything a group could ask for in a leader. He's the producer and spokesperson and the visionary that has guided the Peas from breakdancing on the streets of Los Angeles in the early 90s to performing for legions of fans worldwide at the Super Bowl and the 2010 World Cup in South Africa. Their music has crossed genres, fads, and vast changes in musical taste.
I don't think we look at this as a group. We look at this as a family, friends, and if this was a group, we would have broke up a long time ago, because that's what groups do. Families stay together and support each other in low times, good times, celebrate the good times, and prepare for new things.
My name is Will.i.am. It's William. The end. You know, two periods change everything. Two periods would change everything, man. Change my name to Will.i.am. It changes the end to the energy never dies. It changes electricity to electric city. So I love, you know, splitting words up. I know what I am emotionally. I know what I am creatively. I know what I am as far as a vision. And I know how I can bring the world together. The world looks like booch, 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 booch. That's what it's like.
Like so many popular rap artists of the past, Will.i.am grew up on the mean streets of East L.A., a notoriously dangerous neighborhood that's been known to be the hangout of drug dealers, gang members, and other criminals committing various survival crimes. Will.i.am walked those streets daily, soaking up the culture and doing his best to stay out of trouble.
I'm no different than anybody else. Me, I'm from the projects. How did I do it? The other way. I could have gangbanged. Could have sold dope. I chose not to.
My biggest influence has been music, you know? De La Soul, Tribe Called Quest, Jungle Brothers. And hip-hop, circa 1988, 86. No tricks in 86, it's time to build. Eric Luizzi on the cut, no mistakes allowed, because to me, you know, it's even right. 86 to like 94, that's my hip-hop, I love it.
But Will.i.am was determined to be more than what his hood offered its residents. His mother encouraged him to be unique, to pursue his dreams no matter his surroundings. Will.i.am's mother was adamant that her son follow his dream. She enrolled him in the exclusive Palisades Charter High School, where he discovered his love of music.
I moved my mom out to projects. I was like, Mom, how much was your rent? No, she's like, Willie, how much do you have to pay for mortgage? I was like, $5,000 a month. She was like, what? I was like, yeah. Well, how much you pay rent at the projects? $150 a month, right? So my mom's rent for us growing up in the projects was like $150 a month. This dude was giving $100 like a week for like allowance and shit. I was like, wow, dude, right? And it was just hanging out with App was like dreamland, like, you know, going from the projects to like Los Feliz. I was just dreaming like, wow, one day I'm gonna get a house. One day move my mom out the projects. Cause I saw what having it was like, right? Like, you don't know what, one, you don't know what poor is when everybody around you is poor. It's probably what, you know, Apple probably experienced in the Philippines with no electricity until he moved to my house, like, whoa.
Yeah, to me, the project was luxury. It was like, ooh.
There, he met Alan Lindo, a future member of the Peas, better known by his stage name, Apple D App. The two struck up a friendship that would prove to be long lasting.
Will.i.am and Apple the App and Taboo, when you talk to them about coming up in LA, you know, dancing in high school, that was just a big part of the scene, you know, going to the clubs and really even, you know, at that time, when I guess close to their age. And I don't know if it was just because of the age or the scene, but like going to the clubs and the parties and stuff was just a big thing. So I think in addition to being artists and, you know, knowing how to rap, like they were just really into the dance, you know, and it was that battle dance kind of thing. Not the traditional, you know, break dancing kind of hip hop, but just, you know, the LA scene dancing, and they're really good at it. And I actually was very smart of them to just add this other element to their style, because it's something that's carried on with them till today. Dancing is still a big part of what they do in their act, but you know, it's just different.
Apple Diap arrived in Los Angeles at the age of 14. He was born to a Filipino mother and an African-American father who was an airman in the Air Force. The airman abandoned the family without a trace. Apple has six siblings who grew up poor on the island. He helped his single mother get by farming sweet potatoes, corn, and rice. The family managed to move to Los Angeles in the late 80s, where he would make a connection that would impact the rest of his life.
It's the evolution of us individual.
Mm-hmm.
We've grown as, you know, producers, writers.
I came from the Philippines, and I arrived in 89. Okay. I was adopted, and Will's uncle was living with the person that adopted me. They were roommates, and we was introduced like that.
Oh, okay.
And, you know, we shared the same interests. From then on, it just blossomed. Like
I say, he was like one of my biggest inspirations to Al. Because when he came to America, he would tell me, like, well, I want to live right here where you live. I was like, what? Dude, this is the projects. Why don't you want to live in the projects, dude?
Electricity.
Right? He was like, dude, where I'm from, you know, we didn't even have electricity. I was like, dude, I know, but shit, I'd rather have no electricity than dodging bullets on me. Like, you have to dodge fucking.
Philippines, we had a pretty big, you know, breakdancing hit over there.
Right.
So, and then NWA hit over there, Beastie Boys, Run DMC. So it was there, you know what I mean? So, but when I came over here, that's when I got introduced into more broader, like,
right,
learning
other things.
Yeah, and you know, educating myself and really learning where the stuff came from, you know what I'm saying? Yeah.
Will.i.am and Apple Diap, through their friendship and love of hip hop, formed a conscious rap group called Tribal Nation. The two began breakdancing on the streets of LA, battling other breakdance crews and rapping. Tribal Nation was gathering a large street following, but still, Will.i.am and Apple Diap weren't satisfied with their direction. In 1992, Tribal Nation disbanded, and Will.i.am and Apple Diap formed yet another group called Akbon Clan.
We would go to clubs and battle cats. We would just go battle other dudes. Like, I would battle them rapping, we would battle them dancing, and we built a little name for ourselves in LA. And at that point in time, Ice Cube had left N.W.A. and Dr. Dre had just left N.W.A.
Now five members strong, the group still breakdanced around Los Angeles and were finally discovered by rapper Eazy-E, who was the founder of Ruthless Records.
So Eazy-E was trying to put together a whole new L.A. squad. So he signed up all like the underground rappers and all the underground crews. And we were one of those crews that had record deals.
The group was ecstatic and believed that good times were just ahead. Their debut album, Grassroots, was never released by Ruthless because Eazy-E felt that the positive messages reflected in the group's music wouldn't be marketable.
Well, the Akbon Clan, they were signed to Eazy-E's Ruthless Records. And a lot of people don't know that, you know, you think of the Black Eyed Peas and you think of, you know, all their big pop hits today, but you go back in the roots, you know, you see this other side of them.
In 1995, Eazy-E died of AIDS, and the group's very existence was in limbo.
In high school, when I was 16, Apple's only been in America for 2 years. Probably only been speaking English for like a year and a half, right? And we got a record deal.
I actually was just surprised to know that Eazy-E had saw this talent in these guys, and when you think of Ruthless Records and the gangster rap that was coming out of that label, like, this is totally not the direction they were going in at the time.
Me and Will been together since 92.
Okay.
I mean, since 89, you know, that's when we met. But
okay.
92, that's when we got signed to Ruthless Records.
Okay. Eazy is a smart dude.
Yeah.
Super duper smart. And believed in us, and we had a record deal. And when we just turned 17.
Mm-hmm.
And our record was slated to come out in 95. So we were on there for 3 years. We were getting $150 a week. for we got signed for 10 G's, and every week after that, we would go up there and get our checks. But when we started the P's in 95, after Eazy-E passed away with AIDS, mm-hmm. you know, when he passed away, we started the Black Eyed Peas, and then Taboo joined the group because mm-hmm. We had a crew called Grassroots. So we wanted just to play concerts, because when we were on Ruthless, they told us, you know, we don't want you performing, you know, we wanted to keep it a secret.
Mm-hmm. Labels wasn't feeling the first demo.
Right.
Labels wasn't feeling the second demo. So in 96, we was like, yo, let's just go find our artists.
Do your own, right.
Let's go to UCLA, do right. a show at Northridge. Let's do a show at LMU. Let's do a show at USC. Let's do a show at Long Beach. And you know, we
Dragonfly and all the breakers trying all underground clubs.
Okay. We did all them rock clubs in right. Hollywood.
Right.
All the hip hop spots. Till we created a buzz. To where not only one label, not only the labels that didn't want us, but they all came back.
Came at you.
Like you know, that girl in high school that was ugly. And then she graduated.
Right, yeah, graduated.
She fly.
Came back,
and you seen her at the mall, you were like,
exactly.
Hey, what's
that's
up?
That's you? Damn!
Don't make me wait, come to my house, give me body, right? All that stuff. That's like when hip-hop was like musical, energetic. And that's the kind of hip-hop Black Eyed Peas does, right? Where it's staying true to that era of hip-hop.
They brought on a new member, Jamie Louise Gomez, a.k.a. Taboo. Taboo, also a Los Angelino from Boyle Heights, is a singer, dancer, and rapper whose Mexican and Native American background added yet another element to the melting pot.
From Latin music, growing up in East Los Angeles and then moving to Rosemead, which is a predominantly Mexican-Asian community. From there, I got into hip-hop through graffiti, tagging, breakdancing, breaking back in the days, ultimate b-boying, martial arts. Then I got into MCN in 92, met Will and Apple, and became part of a family called Grassroots, which was inspirational within itself, because we had MCs, musicians, dancers, poets, producers.
We get to experience just the energy and being at this whole event where you see people that you're inspired by. So.
With the new addition and the new direction, the group switched record labels and changed their group name to the Black Eyed Peas.
You know, Black Eyed Peas, being like a soul food from the South.
Okay.
And we're just trying to create music and bring, you know, creativity from the soul and just doing it like that.
A new chapter began, but the canvas was yet to be completed. However, the group still moved forward musically.
And then I met him through dancing. I went to a club called Ballistics, and that's where he was rapping, and Apple was dancing in Cypher. We were doing our Cypher right. thing. And I was like, yo, these cats kind of resemble our crew, because we were right. in San Gabriel, they were in Hollywood and Los Feliz
okay.
area.
We used to drive down the street and see Tower Records and Virgin Megastore and Sam Goody's. Now they don't have that. Now it's more, like App said earlier, the click of a button. So it's the end of that era. Also, the end of the rumors and the misconceptions that Black Eyed Peas is breaking up or separating.
It's just the stamp of us getting back together, and no, we didn't break up, and then that energy never died.
Here we are 10 years later after we opened up for Macy Gray in 1999, 2000, 2001, 2002. In 2006, I signed on my label and put out a record 2007. So we've came full circle. Both of our careers, we've seen ups and downs, you know. We've seen the down in the beginning, you know, seen the ups now. She's seen the ups in the beginning, and we've seen a whole bunch of ups and downs throughout both of our careers. And here we are together making a record called Big.
That's right.
And Chuck D.
Yo, fam, you know, I love y'all, man. What's your name again, fam? You know, your name is crazy.
I like that's the true. Peas. I eat black on peas with rice. Yeah, boy. You know, and
that's cool, though.
P.E. love, you know what I mean? They gave us support.
Yeah.
Q-tip. Yo, cool. We did the show at New York, and dude got on stage and rocked.
In 1998, veterans in the game but still young by industry standards, the Black Eyed Peas were the opening act of the popular Smoking Grooves tour.
Smoking Grooves, and you know, it's been great. Yeah, it's been great. We've been getting a lot of love, you know. So we're going kind of early, but we're still winning the people that's there, and it's just a blessing being with Public Enemy. Man.
They were young and ecstatic and eager to play around hip-hop legends on the tour, such as Public Enemy, Lauryn Hill, Wyclef, Erykah Badu, and the Refugee All-Stars.
Leaders of the New School's first album, 87 and 94. 93. And then a couple of groups like The Roots,
right,
you know,
right,
surprised me. I was right. Like, at first, you know, it's just in hip-hop nature for you to go like, I don't know, I ain't feeling it.
Right.
But then they break your boundaries, and nah, they my biggest, you know, I love that.
Right,
the Roots is just like, inspired us.
The Black Eyed Peas wanted to keep the conscious rap legacy alive, but in 1998, hip-hop music was searching for a new identity. On the heels of the deaths of Notorious B.I.G. and Tupac, audiences were growing fatigued by the whole East-West Coast media war. They turned to something far different than what listeners had been used to. A strange and intoxicating new sound entered the arena.
The black community needed a Tupac at the time when he was alive to give, you know, hope for those that didn't have opportunity to go out and be strong in a society where they were looked at as outcasts.
Southern rap music motored onto the scene, and the likes of Master P and the No Limit Soldiers and Cash Money took over the marketplace.
Well, the music is, you know, it's a lot more clubby. It's hard, but it's clubby, and the music is a lot of up-tempo now. You know, it's definitely dance hall music now.
The Black Eyed Peas, who also produced great music and developed a cult following, but wasn't near the level that these new brand of artists armed with bravado and gold teeth garnered.
Do people buy a record and listen to the whole album anymore? No. They probably take a song and make their own playlist on an iPod.
We just keep on staying ahead of the game and traveling the world, making sure that we stay in touch with what's going on around the world, the pulse of the youth, and we've just been blessed.
Yeah. I don't let people, you know, limit me. That's how they look at me. How I look at myself is what's more important.
The Black Eyed Peas continue to be players in the hip-hop game despite the major industry shift from East Coast-dominated hip-hop to catchy country rap tunes. While the style at the time was still a simple format that featured a DJ and a few dancers, the Black Eyed Peas were reaching for something more creative and outside the box.
Well, I think hip-hop has always been inspired by many different sounds to create your own sound, whether it's, you know, jazzy hip-hop or, you know, straight hardcore, or, you know, it's all hip hop. But you take from different influences to create your own sound. And I feel like Black Eyed Peas, we've been able to transcend and to evolve.
I played the piano.
Okay, piano.
And I played on a couple of songs.
Okay.
I played the theremin. It's like this instrument that you don't touch. It just works off the heat of your body.
Right, right.
Programming, you know, drum programming.
You share the same interest, you know, listening to De La Soul, Tribe Called Quest, Bob Marley to Stevie Wonder.
And, yeah.
You know, just evolved from wanting to learn what we were dancing with, and then that spawned to learning how to produce.
I know what I am. I know who I am. And I know what I'm capable of. And I'm capable to do more than beats and rhyme.
This season, I'm continuing with me personally, my I Am Scholarship, where I send kids to school. I send five more kids to school this year. And sustaining my I Am Home, where I rescue families from losing their homes, especially at this point in time, because people have no jobs and no way to pay for their mortgages. And, you know, I travel around the world and DJ to raise money for that cause. So we'll be doing that next year, this and next year as well.
What? Black Eyed Peas, y'all.
Uh-oh. When we formed the Peas, our whole thing was let's go to colleges and play shows. So we would play and play and play, and then finally we got a record there in 97. Our first record came out in 1998, called Behind the Front.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
The second record came out in 99, called Bridging the Gap.
Mm-hmm.
And at that time, we had three girls that were part of our crew. We always had a girl in the group. Mm-hmm. First one was Kim Hill, second was Estero,
mm-hmm.
and third was Macy Gray, who went down with us since the beginning. And Kim left the group in 2000.
Will.i.am was experimenting in the studio and was in the process of developing a brand new direction for the group. On the business side, he and Jimmy Iovine, the president of Interscope, both felt that the group needed a new direction with the defection of background singer Kim Hill. The search was on for a new diva. Many names were bandied about, from virtual unknowns to popular Pussycat Dolls leader Nicole Scherzinger, but she was already under another contract with Interscope. Will.i.am befriended a little-known singer named Stacey Ferguson, who at the time was the frontwoman for the group Wild Orchid that featured her castmates from the early 90s show Kids Incorporated. She kept attending Black Eyed Peas concerts, and soon she was invited in the studio with the group to try out for the opening in the band. She ended up singing on Shut Up, her first collaboration, and instantly the trio bonded with her. She recorded an additional 5 songs as a guest on the 2003 album, Elephant.
Amazing. Such a great experience to just be there and have that journey. So amazing.
Fergie didn't join until 2003.
Right.
So we toured in 2000, started recording Elephant in 2001. Mm-hmm. 2002 was a very low point for the Peas. It was depressing and question marks everywhere. Like, we didn't know what was up. Mm-hmm. We wrote Words of Love, and the whole record was done. And then, right when the record was gonna come out, that's when we met Fergie and put her on a couple of songs on the record and launched with her in the group.
Interscope head honcho Jimmy Iovine loved the odd mixing of the group and its new diversity. He quickly signed the energetic young blonde before Elefunk hit the market, and the world would forever come to know Stacey Ferguson merely as Fergie.
This is your girl Fergie. Got that boom boom pow for you.
I was actually very shocked when Fergie joined the Black Eyed Peas and they went pop, because it was very different than the earlier sound of the group. And it took me a long time to accept this new, you know, more mainstream sound.
Crazy. But the win was before the performance.
Yeah, so.
So it was even crazier because we won. Usually, you know, you have a bottle of champagne.
You know, it's crazy right now.
Great.
It's like when you said on the song.
That's I'm in character.
I'm in character.
I don't know. I want to sample that right there.
Great. 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 Doing some things, I'm, you know, I'm getting my feet wet.
I know you've done the occasional
getting,
thing,
getting
you know.
The nerves out of the way.
But the real record, the first record where it was like real glue and it was cemented, Fergie and the Peas, was Elephant, was Monkey Business. Mm. That was the one.
Instantly, the fortunes changed for the eclectic group with Fergie as the lead. They embarked on a worldwide tour, spreading their techno rap fusion all over the globe, from the UK, Australia, Japan, and France. Their musical influence had no boundaries.
It's fun to hang out with my homies and travel around the world. And that's, you know, all the inspiration, music.
We're trying to, like, feed the appetite of the audience out there, you know. We're trying to make it as an experience, and it'll update itself as it goes along.
That their songs have been played at, like, the World Cup, and they play for, you know, stadiums with, like, tens of thousands, you know, of people. Like, it's just, that's what they want to do. They couldn't be happier about that. And while, you know, some people in hip-hop, like, may criticize them for their desire to reach this broad audience, this is actually exactly what they wanted to do.
All right, you got a hit record. You made $20 million. That ain't a lot of money, because you had to pay taxes on it, and you had to do commissions. So your $20 million, cut it in half, 10, after you paid your taxes and commission. So you probably made like $9 million. It's not a lot of money. I mean, it is if you had no money. You know what's a lot of money? The dudes that started Facebook. That's like $1 billion. That's like lots of billions.
Yeah, Where's the Love was, it stemmed also from the 9/11 events.
Mm.
We were actually recording our album, Elefunk, up north. And when that happened, you know, we were supposed to go on tour on the 13th.
Yeah.
Right after September 11th. And well, you know, we were kind of skeptical about going out. Like, you know, what's it gonna be like?
Mm.
You know, we were skeptical. And then Will's grandmother said, no, you know, it's your duty. God intended you guys to be out there.
Mm.
So we started traveling and seeing how much racism and how much kind of stereotyping was going on. I think for me, personally, it's just sacrificing to kind of like pave the way for my son. I had my son at 17, and that's been my biggest obstacle, but it's been good because I've grown and I've learned that to sacrifice is good because I'm paving the way for his future and my children's future.
A lot of kids will go to school aimless, not knowing how they're gonna contribute, not know what it's for, not know the importance of science and technology and mathematics and engineering, right? So this show is important so they could see that science and technology is cool. And don't be afraid to dream those type of dreams and put yourself in a position to execute those dreams into reality.
Acknowledging the power that they have, their voice or choice, making, defining and deciding on what's cool and what's not cool, what's fresh and what's not fresh, what's successful and what sucks. You know, these kids, if Black Eyed Peas, if they didn't like our music, we would not be what we are today. You know, if they didn't want to buy iPads and iPods, Apple wouldn't be what Apple is today.
A kid should not just want to be an athlete or an entertainer or a model. They should want to be engineers. They should want to be scientists. Why not?
I think it's important for people to feel like it's okay and they don't have to feel like an outcast because they're autistic. They're not maybe getting the best grades or they're not mathematically inclined. I just think there's right brain and there's left brain. And you really have to focus on what your talents are and what your drive is and what your creativity.
In 2005, the group released Monkey Business, an album that was mostly recorded on the John Lennon Educational Tour Bus that allowed them to stay on the road while recording their new album in the mobile studio. Monkey Business debuted in the top 10 on Billboard charts. Musically, Black Eyed Peas had found their groove. They won a Grammy for Best Rap Performance by a Duo or Group in 2005 and hit the road again, this time with Gwen Stefani.
Gosh, I listen to everybody. I put my iPod on shuffle and it's just kind of this schizophrenic, eclectic mix of music.
Yeah, Where's the Love is a very special song. It was very therapeutic for us individually. We were all going through our dark times, but when we wrote that song, that kind of united us and reminded us of our friendship and what we're here for and what our goals are.
I think the legacy that the Black Eyed Peas is going to leave as a group is that, you know, they found the path to global success and they were able to keep it going for a while in a major way. Because if you look at the course of hip hop, look at artists who've really been able to do this kind of thing, their, you know, tenure has been short-lived. You know, I think they want, even though they want that, I think they want more than that. They want to be respected as credible artists, and I think that's what they're doing. And when you consider some of the people that they've worked with,
I have an ability to bring that world here and bring everybody a little closer and do things with my vision, you know. And I'm proud of that, and I'm not stopping anytime soon.
I think for sure Fergie is more responsible for the global success of the group. There's a couple ways to look at it. I mean, I would give both of them a lot of credit, and also have the complete dynamics of the group. You have like a multicultural group, you know, which, you know, Ap-Da-Ap is from the Philippines, you know, Taboo is Mexican, American, Will.i.am is Black, and Fergie is white.
I just love kind of the fusion of it all. A lot of our shows, especially with the Peas, are very theatrical, almost like a play. So it kind of incorporates both of that.
An album that lives in the clubs.
Yeah.
Deeper electro beats. It's very club oriented. It's kind of an homage to the DJs, because Apple and Will are both rich DJs that go out every night at the Bash for this, ladies and gentlemen. Do you want to pose a competition? Any other group or artist who goes out to the club more?
Too. Cats go out and spend all this money on these cars. You know, is it hard to make your own car? How come people ain't dreaming to make their own vehicles?
It's like if you practice positivity and you're a positive person, you build a aura.
Mm-hmm.
a good karma aura, right? And people call that good luck. Mm-hmm. Oh, he always got good luck. It ain't good luck. It's that person is positive.
Right.
And he got good karma around him.
Right.
And a karma aura is like a magnet. And it attracts whatever you are. So if you're a negative person, negative things are always going to come.
Right.
You'll be in jail.
Right.
Get pulled over.
Uh-huh.
Then get caught.
Right.
If you're a positive person, things will come to you.
Okay.
And it's like good luck. And turn of the year, people eat black eyed peas for good luck.
Okay.
And, you know, we eat positive mugs.
Right.
Tom Hanks reached out to us, seeing him at the Grammys, reached out and asked to come and perform. And the cause itself was all that needed to be said.
By 2006, the Black Eyed Peas had made their imprint all over the world. Their immense popularity reached its apex in Rio de Janeiro, where the group performed for over 1 million fans, making it the largest concert crowd ever.
We'll probably have like 200 things of that came from the end, you know? Instrumentals, songs with people that, you know, that we like, and not necessarily us on it, but it's still part of our record, right? Just as producers and DJs.
The Black Eyed Peas are very confident they want to have global success. They don't want to just, you know, be successful in their, you know, in their area where they're from, their hometown. And you can definitely feel that in their music. And even if you like consider the way the sound has evolved, like on one of the earlier songs that they did, they took out the hit Lookout Weekend, and they did like they flipped that. And so that was like a popular, you know, LA kind of party song that they took and they made into a hip hop record. That was definitely very reflective of the sound in LA. But, you know, as you just continue to look at their music and how it's evolved over the years, whether it's I Got a Feeling or Boom Boom Pow, these are still, you know, party oriented songs, but they're just kind of made to reach a larger audience.
I'm ready for Will.i.am.
I'm ready
producer
for Will.i.am.
Producer of the year right here. Yes, this man lives in the studio. He
really?
Deserves it.
I got a bed right next to the board.
The Black Eyed Peas' worldwide exposure had made each member of the group wealthy and thinking careers outside of the collective.
Our last Black Eyed Peas record, we sold, you know, 11 million albums. And Elephunk, we sold 9 million records, 10 million records worldwide. So you could say that, you know, there's no way we could sell that many records again. So instead of asking the question, how do we sell that many records, you have to ask the right question. And that question is, why are we going to make another record?
Will.i.am began producing outside projects for artists such as John Legend, Nelly Furtado, Justin Timberlake, Usher, and even Michael Jackson. He also worked with old friend Macy Gray.
Macy Gray worked with the, you know, Black Eyed Peas earlier on, and I think she sounded good with them. I think this Lookout Weekend is one of the songs she's on, if I'm correct. I think she was a great fit for that sound. As is Fergie though, Macy Gray is like, so eclectic, and like it's hard, I think, just having a personality like Macy Gray in a group where, you know, she's just one of the group members. You know, I think she needed the full range to just like be her own artist so that she can explore more of that. You know, I think she would have worked out well with the Black Eyed Peas, though I do also think that what Macy Gray's, you know, sound and appeal is quite different from Fergie. I mean, Macy Gray has that very distinct, you know, kind of nasally, you know, kind of sound that was very successful in a lot of, you know, a lot of big hits for her. But I don't think of it in the same, you know, mainstream crossover way, pop way that Fergie was able to bring to the group. And I think that's what they, you know, I think that's what they needed.
It's amazing to see, to go online and see like an 8-year-old singing Boom Boom Pow.
Well, I'm excited.
excited. It's my second full show I've ever done. You know, I'm kicking off my tour, so I'm really excited right now. All right,
Fergie's solo album, The Duchess, was released in the fall of 2006. The Duchess spawned six hits and garnered Fergie a Grammy nomination and an American Music Award for Best Female Pop Vocal Performance in 2007. That same year, she was named Woman of the Year by Blender Magazine. She also returned to acting and made appearances in the movie Poseidon, Grindhouse, and Nine.
You know, it was really relaxing for me because as a musician, you know, I was touring and you're in a different hotel room every night, sleeping in different beds, and this was one place in London.
When X-Men only brought, you know, new inspiration and I learned a lot of how the process of making movies and how intricate you should be and how protective you should be of the stuff you're making. Because in this day and age of life, you know, with the internet, that stuff could go everywhere in a hot second.
But I see something coming that inspires everyone to lead. I see that coming.
Okay.
Hey, Black Eyed Peas, muy internacional.
How do you say Black Eyed Peas in Spanish?
Negro
ojos. Frijoles negros.
See? I don't want to say it in Japanese.
By 2008, the Black Eyed Peas had attained superstardom. With money and fame in hand, each member began to carve out their own niche. Will.i.am used his musical influence to support presidential candidate Barack Obama.
Yeah, Will.i.am was very significant in the Obama campaign, so he had the whole Yes We Can, and he made a song, and I don't know whose idea was it, but he brought in all these other artists and he got them on camera singing and he made a video. And considering how popular viral videos are and just how popular the Obama campaign was in general, it was very instrumental in like reaching this young audience. And they say like the youth vote was very significant in helping get Obama in office.
I learned a lot. And all it does is make the peace stronger, makes our reach broader. You know, stuff I did politically in 08.
Today, I say to you that the challenges we face are real. They are serious and they are many. They will not be met easily or in a short span of time. But know this, America, they will be met.
He created public service announcements on his behalf and rallied the young vote behind the charismatic politician en route to helping making him the first Black president of the United States. To cap off the feat, Will.i.am performed at Obama's star-studded inaugural ball.
Projects are projects right now because there's no opportunity. There was an opportunity 20 years from now, 20 years ago. And that's why people in the neighborhood are in the situation they're in. So that means we got another 20 years of no opportunity, and then ghettos in 20 years from now are going to be even worse than they are now. It's like, nah, man. There's one thing to rep the streets, and there's another thing to fix the streets.
Two ways of bringing people together, right? You can say, like, let's come together, but in China, they like, I really don't understand what you're talking about. Right? So what you do is you try to find a commonality between all races and ethnicities, and that commonality is dancing.
The group also had philanthropic interests through the Peapod Foundation that funds various children's charities around the world.
The Peapod Foundation that's, you know, supporting foster kids and giving them equipment and tools to go out in the world and do things that they love, and that's if they believe in music.
Right. Tom Hanks reached out to us, seeing him at the Grammys, reached out and asked to come and perform. And the cause itself was all that needed to be said.
I give Will.i.am a lot of credit for all of his philanthropic efforts. Like, he's from South Central, you know, he's from East LA. And so that's really important to him that he gives back. He definitely has not forgotten where he came from. Like, you consider how successful they are, you know, but whenever you talk to him, he's always talking about, look, this is where I came from, and, you know, I'm concerned about the kids. And it isn't like the typical rap way, you know, where people are bragging about where I used to sell drugs. You know, it's not that kind of thing. It's just like, look, I know what these kids are going through. My heart is with the kids, and so whatever I can do, I'm going to do. So he has the Peapod Foundation, you know, so he DJs, you know, gives back in that way.
I got an Apple Foundation, which helps kids from the Philippines. I was adopted as a kid.
from this foundation called Pearl S. Buck. So this year I'm helping out a good amount to help out the kids.
2009 had proved to be a very busy time for the group. Fergie tied the knot with actor Josh Duhamel. The two originally met back in 2004 when the Black Eyed Peas guest starred on Duhamel's hit television show, Vegas. The honeymoon didn't last for long. Black Eyed Peas refocused and released The End in June 2009.
The ends are faster on this record, if you can believe that. And it's just got a new electro-futuristic sound.
It's not the end of the Black Eyed Peas, but it's the end of a lot of other things, like the traditional music business, corrupted politics. It's the end of stereotypes and perceptions. The end that, you know, the end of the concept that America would never overcome their, you know, racial boundaries. And that has come to an end.
Will.i.am has got so many projects going on. Fergie's, you know, has so many opportunities going on. And I think it's hard trying to juggle all that. I mean, when they release one of these albums, considering the money that it costs to produce it, etc., like, they have to be committed to the full promotion of it. So that's, what, a year making a record, another year or so touring. Like, that's a major, you know, a major commitment. And I think they just want to, you know, take advantage of exploring some of their other opportunities.
Stay healthy and focused, because you got to keep yourself in shape and healthy on the road, because, it, you know, it's wear and tear on the road.
Yeah, get ready for the flights, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah!
When do I feel the most glamorous? You know what? On days like this, when I get to go to different foundations and really meet people, when it's not about me, when it's about them, that's when I feel the best about myself.
I also think different years is different for us. You know, some years you really want to perform, and other years you kind of want to kick back and just enjoy the show.
Yeah, I want to be performing though.
Musically, the group had taken their game up a few notches, garnering several American Music Awards and selling millions of units of The End worldwide. They performed everywhere from the Oprah Winfrey TV specials to British chat shows. Heading into 2010, the group had plenty of momentum from the previous year. Fergie released her own personal fragrance called Outspoken, and she even embarked on a press tour promoting the product. Although Fergie was building up an impressive resume outside of the Black Eyed Peas, she still was loyal to her base as the vocal leader of the group. The Black Eyed Peas released yet another project titled The Beginning.
We're trying to, like, feed the appetite of the audience out there, you know. We're trying to make it as an experience, and it'll update itself as it goes along.
Considered by many worldwide to be the premier hip-hop band, they were invited by FIFA to be the opening act to kick off the 2010 World Cup in South Africa. Their performance in South Africa led to the group performing at halftime at the Super Bowl, although to mixed reviews, and Canada's Grey Cup.
I think the legacy that the Black Eyed Peas is going to leave as a group is that, you know, they found the path to global success, and they were able to keep it going for a while in a major way. Because if you look at the course of hip hop, look at artists who've really been able to do this kind of thing, their, you know, tenure has been short lived.
I was in a project, so I was 26, right? WIC, food stamps, government cheese, whole thing. After school lunches, summer school lunch programs, stand in line to get a hot meal, that whole nine, that, just like everybody else from the hood. But I made it out, moved everybody out. Am I supposed to just leave everybody there? People that took care of me, that, you know, family that helped me out, am I supposed to leave everybody? Nah.
I had one of the most amazing days last year doing the Avon Walk for Breast Cancer, and I'm definitely going to do it again and get more involved with that. It's just such an amazing project, and the passion in these people's eyes, it's just such a wonderful feeling. So both my parents are survivors, so it's a cause that's very close to my heart. My dad is stage 4 and my mom is stage 2. So I'll be doing more with that.
Yeah, me coming from a, you know, third world country and being adapted and, you know, being able to support my family. So that's, you know, one of the obstacles that I was able to overcome. Now I'm able to help them out you know, send money back and bring him over here to be with me.
And for me, it's, you know, moving your family out the projects. It's one thing, like, to move your mom out the projects. And then when you got your aunt and your uncles and your grandma in the projects. So I just moved my last family members out the projects on my birthday, which was like 2 weeks ago. So now there's no more family in the projects. And now the obstacle is to keep it, you know, provide, send my nephews and cousins to college. So that's really it.
I'm very happy. Yes, I'm right where I'm supposed to be right now. Happily married, about to go on tour, getting to do things with Mac and the Viva Glam campaign. It just fulfills me as well as helping others. And that's what's the wonderful thing about it.
There's a new thing that's getting ready to be born in the Black community. It's a new hero that's coming. But a hero that inspires everyone to lead, right? The Black community always needed a leader, whether it's Martin Luther King or Tupac.
I think, you know, 20 years from now, when people look back like, hey, in the 2000s, you know, I think people were just, oh, there was this huge party group, the Black Eyed Peas. The part that's kind of iffy about that is that I definitely think there's more to them, especially Fergie and Will I Am, in terms of other things that they've done. But I think, you know, just decades from now, people are going to say, oh, there was this massive party group that had all these huge hits, you know. So I think what the guys are trying to do now is make sure that, you know, the legacy, you know, that they could have, you know, comparable accolades for the other things that they do, so people don't just remember them as, you know, oh, the party, you know, the stadium part. I think they're more so hip hop earlier on, but now I would say I would think they're hip hop because the music is, you know, is played more so, you know, on pop radio first, you know, than hip hop. I think some certain select songs, you know, might get picked up by the hip hop stations, but I think it's definitely hip hop.
Even though the group has been at the top of their game, they've had plenty of wear and tear over the years since they first arrived on the scene in 1992. So the question must be asked, have they fulfilled their goals musically? The members, all now in their 30s, are still striving for excellence in music. But is the end on the horizon for the foursome? Apple the App has a rare genetic eye disorder that has left him legally blind. Will.i.am has developed tinnitus, a hearing disorder. Fergie is looking to start a family with husband Josh Duhamel. And Taboo has solo aspirations and a chance at an acting career.
I'm proud to have these guys as friends and with like-minded passions. I love you guys from the bottom of my heart, guys.
Everybody was supporting the Black Eyed Peas and coming out and being thrilled with us right before the album comes out tomorrow. Thank you all very much.
Thank you.
Support LA Hip Hop. We love y'all. Thank you all very much.
My name is Apple the App.
My name is Taboo No Watch.
My name is Will I Am.
And we're the Black Eyed Peas.
And we chilling with Tony.